Okay, so we've looked at comparative variability. We've looked at comparative two means. So what happens if you have a violation of your assumptions for the means, or you simply need to compare the medians to begin with? So the two population parameters we'll be talking about here are going to be theta 1 versus theta 2, two population medians. And the test that we will use is known as the Wilcoxon rank sum. There are several different tests for the medians, but this is the one that we chose for our TC stats, and this is the one that we'll be addressing here. Now again, the data types applicable will be interval and ratio. The Wilcoxon rank test, rank sum test, example of what's known as a non-parametric test. We've seen non-parametric tests before. Well, the sine test is the first non-parametric test that we saw when we did the sine test when we want to compare a mean, a believed mean, with a sample mean, or with a sample is to see if that believed mean is supported or not. And if we had a violation of the assumptions for the two sample t, we switch to the median and work with the sine test. Now, there are some advantages to non-parametric tests. These non-parametric tests are very commonly referred to as distribution-free tests. In other words, when we did a one sample and a two sample t test, for the one sample t, we assume x is distributed normal. And for the two sample t, we decided that x1 had to be normal, the first population, and x2 had to be normal, the second population. Distribution-free simply means these assumptions are not needed. So, in other words, they work for all distributions. But we're still limiting it to interval and ratio data. Now, a major disadvantage, and some would argue whether this is really major or not, but I think one of the major disadvantages is that these non-parametric tests are typically very conservative. And it makes sense. If you have a technique that works on all distributions, it can't be as exact as something that works for a specific distribution. Think of it as the empirical rule in comparison to Chebyshev's. Chebyshev's works everywhere, but it's extremely conservative as compared to the empirical rule. It's the exact same idea. So we're going to continue using the exact same scenario that we've been working on. It's the same furniture data, the exact same sort of thing. Now we'd want to start off by using the two sample t-test. And here, what we're going to be emphasizing is the number of blemishes. We're not going to address the variability here. Now the assumptions, we've already gone through them. A sample data is obtained for two independent populations, and the distribution for both populations are normal. Well, we've already discussed a couple of times why these are independent, two different machines. And we've already looked at the normal plots. And for this example, we're going to assume that either one or both were not normal. We've already looked at them and says, well, the current could be questionable. The new looked pretty good. So at this point, we're going to say that the was in fact not normal. And again, just to look at it quickly to refresh your memory, here's the current. So this should be drawn in your paper somewhere. And we're going to say that because of this and this, it's not normal. Well, if one of these is not normal, then we can't use the t-test. Matter of fact, if one of them's not normal, and I'm convinced it's not normal, it's a gross violation, then I'm not even going to bother looking at the second. There's no reason to. What we like to do is we want to say H naught mu current minus mu nu is zero. They're the same. The alternative would be mu current minus mu nu is greater than zero. We're looking to see if this one's smaller. But we can't because of the violation of the assumption. So instead, we're going to say theta of the current minus theta of the nu equals one, and then the alternative, I'm sorry, equals zero. And the alternative is theta of the current minus theta of the new is greater than 0. Sorry, I didn't leave myself much room there. Alpha, we're going to leave at 0.05 because there's nothing here regarding the significance level. And we will use the Wilcoxon rank sum test. So I'm back to TC stats, and I'm going to go back to two samples. And right there is the Wilcoxon rank sum. Select the data. And you can see the null alternative is already set up. Again, the default here is fine for this example. But again, I always change it to equals. And keep in mind, the null hypothesis does not affect the p-value. It's the alternative hypothesis that affects the p-value. Again, my data is not stacked. So all I have to do is tap update. There's my p-value, and it gives the sample means, and it gives the sample medians. I'm sorry, the sample medians. It does not give the sample means. Sorry, I misspoke. So I'm going to write down some of that information. The median, sample median for the current was 17. The sample median for the new was 15. And that got kind of messy there, sorry. There we go, it's a 17. The p-value was 0.0772. So my decision would be fail to reject because this is greater than alpha. And then the conclusion is there is not enough evidence to suggest the median from the new process is smaller or less than, whatever you want to say, than the current process. Now, there's one more thing that's kind of cool about the Wilcoxon rank sum. If you can show the shapes of the distributions are, I'm going to say, similar, then the Wilcoxon rank sum will actually allow you to continue the hypothesis test for the mean. If the shapes are not similar, then you have to switch and look at the differences between the two medians. And by the same or by similar, what I mean is, as an example, both are skewed right, or both are skewed left. If that's the case, then I could have stayed with the means. And the reason for that is this is how the Wilcoxon rank sum actually works. Suppose I have data set number one, and I have data set number two. Now for data set number one, I have the first value, the second value, the third value, the fourth value, and so forth. I'm going to stop at four just for sake of discussion here. And then likewise, the second has the first value, the second value, the third value, and the fourth value. Now, if these two were actually, two samples actually came from the population, same population, then if I put them together, I would expect them to be intermingled, such that perhaps this is maybe overemphasized, but together they may look like 1, 2, 3, 4, and 1, 2, 3, 4. So they're just completely intermingled with each other. So this would have rank 1, and they tied, so they tied at rank 1. Rank 2, they tied, and so forth. More detail on this is given in the textbook. I just want to give you a rough idea here. So if I add up the ranks, then these ranks are going to be very similar to each other. Now, on the other hand, if the distributions were separated, I may get something that looks like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, and perhaps 1, 2, 3, 4. Sorry, that should have been blue. I hit the wrong color. 1, two, three, four. Now I'm going to rank these. Clearly the blue is shifted to the right, so it's going to have higher ranks. So I'm going to draw these as if they were normal curves, but you know they're not. I'm just going to draw them that way to make the discussion a little bit more simple. If this were the first distribution, what this ranking is suggesting is that the second distribution is sitting up here someplace. So this median is expected to be bigger than this median. This first distribution actually suggests, I'm going to do this one in red now, that perhaps the distributions are more like this, and that the median 1 is actually equal to median 2. That's what this ranking would suggest. So that's what the Wilcoxon rank sum actually does. It actually compares the distributions. So that is why if both of these are skewed right or both are skewed left, I can compare the distributions and stay with the means. So let's just briefly here, let's go back and quickly look at some more graphs. And I want box plots, and I want both of them. And here, both of these look relatively symmetric, not bad at all. The current, they do look very symmetric. So the distributions do have the similar shape. And remember when we looked at these normal plots originally, we kind of like, they do kind of look normal. You could argue the current may not have been normal. But in general, they look like they weren't too bad. And that's what we're seeing here in the box plots. So we see them of the similar shape, so we could have stayed with the means and still use the Wilcoxon rank sum, but the null and alternative hypothesis would still have been about the means. That's kind of a cool characteristic of the Wilcoxon rank sum based on the non-parametric approach of using the ranks.